and hatred and bitterness, what does that do to you? It destroys you. It destroys you. It's so funny that people who are so bitter and they're so angry, they're so upset, so they want to do whatever they want to do, it doesn't make their life any better. They just get worse. They get bad. They just allow this thing to just consume them and eat them up. It's like rottenness in their bone. Being angry and being unforgiving, I've said it before, I'll say it again, I love this statement. It's like you drinking poison and waiting for the other person to die. It really is. You drinking poison and ready and waiting for someone else to die. Doesn't work that way. Doesn't work that way. We're encouraged and reminded to walk in the Spirit. We're also encouraged as mature believers to restore weaker ones by teaching them and reminding them of the grace of God and living for God. When we find people who are weak in the Spirit, when we find people who are weak, maybe they tripped, they stumbled, maybe they resorted back to the law, maybe, you know, there's all these things that are happening. We who are mature are called not to judge or to criticize or to point, but rather to say, come on, the grace of God is there. God's love and his forgiveness are there. You know, a statement was said a long time ago that Christians were known to kill their wounded. To kill their wounded. You find a wounded Christian, and many Christians look at that and go, oh, look at that guy. Look at her. Look at who she thinks she is. Oh, yeah. You know, we're not building them up. What are we doing? We're just tearing them down. I'm self-righteous. I can't believe. Instead of, hey, it's all right, man. Come on. Get up. You can do this. You can fight this. God gives you the victory. God gives you the spirit to overcome this mountain in your life. You may be in the valley, but you got to kick that out. Come on, God says, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, not when I tent in it, not when I live in it. Come on, get on up. You can do this. We've got to be people to encourage other people to live for God, to raise up and do what God calls them to do. Even when they're weak, even when they feel like they can't do it, we need people in our life to do that, to encourage. You who are spiritual, restore such a one when one is overtaken in sin. Amen? In a trespass, in a fault. We are also called to sow into our spiritual life. To sow. We are sowing in our life today. You are here at church, and you know what you're doing? You're sowing into your spiritual life. You're putting into your life the good things. When you hear the word of God, when you're in the car and you got the Christian music going, when you're listening to sermons on YouTube by Pastor Mike, which is a great preacher, you should listen to him. When you're seeing all these things, all these things you're sowing, when you're praying, you're sowing. When you're fellowshipping, you're sowing. God says you will reap. If you sow into your spiritual things, you will reap spiritual things. But if you sow into your life in the flesh, what are you going to reap? Corruption and destruction. He always makes me laugh when people come to me and I don't know why I'm going through what I'm going through. I don't know why I'm always poor. I don't know why I'm always depressed. I don't know. What are you listening to? What are you watching? Why you act all stupid like that? You think God has no idea. You know why you go through what you're going through. Many people who go through what they go through, they know why they got what they got. They've been sowing into, I don't know why. This guy I spoke to this past week, he was talking, I said, how you doing, man? He's, not too good. Oh, my life. Wah, 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 wah. And I was just really calling to encourage him to do the right thing. And I know why he was going through what he was going through. I knew why his life was miserable. I know why his life is like that. Because he's been sowing into his life the flesh. He's been putting things of the flesh into his life. And what is he reaping? The flesh. Amen? Come Come on, man. If I walk around eating cupcakes and Twinkies my entire life and try to figure out why I can't get from point A to point B without being so tired. And that's the junk that people are feeding into their lives. They're putting all this junk, this spiritual junk food, this flesh junk food into their lives, and they come to the gym, I call this, for 30 minutes, and then they walk out and try to figure out why they're not spiritually in shape. Because they're sowing into their flesh, and they're reaping corruption. Sowing. We are called to sow good things. And people are like, well, I went to church last week. Why isn't my life better? I prayed. I don't understand why aren't things. Listen, it's silly for me to go to Home Depot and get a tomato seed and put it into the ground, right? Put it into the ground, bury it, put water, walk away, and the next day come out and go, I don't get it. Where's the tomato?
Takes a while.
We got to give it water. We got to give it sun. We got to give it time. And let me tell you something. Let me say this. The most important part of the whole seed part is the seed has to die first. It has to die. Amen? It has to die. If that seed don't die, it ain't going to grow. And there's a lot of reasons why we're not growing spiritually is because that flesh seed hasn't died yet. The Apostle Paul says, I am crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who lives, but Christ that lives within me. Crucified. He had to emphasize that he was crucified. His flesh had to die first. And then he sowed spiritually, and he continued, and he grew. So you're not going to, may not get it overnight. It's going to take time. But you know what? Don't be weary. Don't give up. Turn to neighbor and say, don't give up. Don't give up. Don't give up. Amen? Rome wasn't built in a day. Rome wasn't built in a day. Don't give up. Okay? Empires are not built in a day. I don't care what your Minecraft says to you. It's not built. It's not like that. Takes time. Amen? Well, let's continue and we conclude the text. See with what large letters I have written to you with my own hand, the Apostle Paul writes, verse 11. As many as desire to make a good showing in the flesh, these would compel you to be circumcised, only that they may not suffer persecution for the cross of Christ. For not even those who are circumcised keep the law, but they desire to have you circumcised that you may boast in your flesh. And let me give it to you exegesis, and then I'll give it to you practical. The Apostle Paul says, hey, they know that if they teach against circumcision and they just teach about faith in Christ, they will be persecuted by the Jews. Jews will persecute them because they think they're going against Moses' law. He says, So to relieve themselves of persecution, they add circumcision to their Christianity. And the Apostle Paul says, you can't do that. You can't do that. You can't do that. Because even if you just got circumcised, you can't even obey the rest of the law. In our modern day practicality, I give you to the Seventh-day Adventists, who say that you must worship on Saturday because it is the Sabbath. And if you keep the Sabbath, you will be fine. You know, and it's not so much that you just keep the Sabbath, but you'll be made righteous if you keep the Sabbath. But many of them, if I sit down and say, well, have you been circumcised? Well, no, because we're not in the law. Well, what makes you think you can find righteousness in the law? Well, I don't. Well, you just told me that if I obey the Sabbath, I'll be more righteous or be right with God. Do you understand that they don't even obey the law? So you can't just pick one verse or one law and pull it out and make your whole denomination that. You can't do that. You can't do that. You either obey one or you obey all or none. To us, we know we can't. That's why we have Christ who fulfills the law and gives us righteousness. Amen? Now, I want to talk to you about compelling you to be circumcised only that they may not suffer persecution. I'll give you the worldview now of what the world tries to do for you. It's tough being a Christian. You know why? Because you stand against the world. I don't serve the king of beers. I serve the king of kings. I don't need your drugs. I don't need this. I don't need that. I don't love the world or the things in the world. Christians don't love the world. They're not part of the world. But the problem what happens is the world persecutes you and it comes against you and it tries to destroy you and it hits you and it bangs on you. And you know what? Unfortunately, a lot of Christians decide to obey the world and walk in the world so they don't suffer persecution. But the Bible tells me that those who live godly shall suffer persecution. They shall suffer persecution. So what if you're persecuted? So what if people don't like you? So what if you're not an in crowd? So what if you're not popular? So what if you're not number one, prom king, prom queen, all that hocus pocus? So what? So what if you don't go out with your friends to the bar after work? So what if they look at you like you're some prude? And like you're, oh, look at that, oh, Miss Holy, Mr. Holy of Holies. So what, the Bible thumper, holy roller, so what? My Bible tells me, Jesus says, blessed are you when you are persecuted for my name's sake. For they persecuted who first? The prophets and Christ. If they called Jesus the son of the devil, what do you think they're going to call you who are his servants? Praise God. They try to compel you to follow the world. Oh, you know what? Just give in. Be liberal. Just be acceptance. Just accept it. It's just our revolving. All these fake apostate denomination, United Methodist, Evangelical Lutheran churches, United Church of Christ, all these apostate churches, and all these apostate Christians who call themselves Christians and say, oh, we just need to be acceptance and loving. You know, you liar. You just don't want to be persecuted for this, for what God stands for. That's what it is. Don't bow down to the statue. Don't bow down to it. He'll tell you, obey the world. Obey the world. Love the world. Love, love, love. Love is what makes the world go round. But don't obey that. You are Christians. You are born again. God has called you as holy people, a peculiar nation, a royal priesthood. God has called you to something greater and special. So what if they persecute me? So what if they throw me in the fire? So what if they put me in the lion's den? I need to stand for God. They try to compel you to be circumcised, only that they may not suffer persecution for the cross of Christ. Hey, so what? We will obey and follow Christ, even if they persecute us. Amen? Verse 14, but God forbid. I love that word. I love it in the Arabic because it's even more stronger. Astaghfirullah azim. Isn't that awesome word? I know it just sounds like God forbid, but no, astaghfirullah azim. Wow. I know, right? It's like, astaghfirullah azim. God forbid. It's almost like, astaghfirullah azim is like blasphemy. Like, how dare you? No way. God forbid. See, we go, oh, God forbid. Oh, you know, what if you were in a car accident? God forbid. No, this is stronger. But God forbid that I should boast except in the what? In the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. I love this. By whom the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. Hallelujah. I love that. The world has been crucified to me and I to the world. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision avails much, but a new creation. And as many as walk according to this rule, peace and mercy upon them and upon the Israel of God. From now on, let no one trouble me, for I bear in my body the marks of the Lord Jesus. Brethren, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Amen. I love that. The world has been crucified to me, and I to the world. I love that. Have you ever heard this statement? You are dead to me. We need to look at the world and say, world, you are dead to me. I'm done with you, world. You are so wicked and evil. I will stand for God. I don't care what you say, Michael Jackson. We are not the world. Amen. We are the world. We are the children. We are the ones who make a better. I haven't seen no better day. I think our world is worse now. It's just getting worse and worse and worse and more evil and godless. That's what the world does. It self-destructs. It destroys itself. But God says in his word, but I am what? Crucified to the world. The world has been crucified to me and I to the world. Stop being the world. Stop looking like the world. Stop acting like the world. And stop trying to make the world like you. Amen? Stop trying. You're special to God. God has called you special. You're his. You're his. I would be offended if my kids called everyone daddy. Oh, that's my dad. Oh, I love that guy. I love. That's not the way it works. Amen? They're all my daddy. I love them all. And then treat me like I'm just like one of them. I'll be offended. And yet we have Christians who are calling everything daddy. Oh, that guy, he's a great motivational speaker. Oh, I love that guy. I follow this. I follow that. I follow that. Oh, Jesus is teaching. I follow Jesus is teaching. It's great. And loving everything else. You're not like that. We have one God, one Father, one Lord, one Dad, Jesus Christ. He is our Dad. He's our Father. He's our God. He loves us. We are His. How insulting it is when we want to love anything other than God. Oh, we love the world. God says, if you love the world, the love of the Father is not in you. You cannot. Friendship with the world is enemies to God, is enmity with God. You know how insulting it is? I'll give you an example. If I looked at Pearl and said, Pearl, you're special, Pearl. You are so special. I love you, Pearl. You're special. Oh, Tori, you're special too. You're special too, Tori. You two are special. Oh, and Sandy, you too. You know what? All of you guys are special. You're all special. I love you all. What did I just do? I took that special and made it so common that Pearl, who felt so like, this is me, is now like, really? It watered it down, didn't it? I took that and I spread it so thin that now the word special is like, amen? Let me give you in practical terms, not everyone who is your Facebook friend is your friend. So get over it. Okay? If you have friends that are in your hand, you've done well. You can count as many as you're in your finger. You've done well. Now, there are family and all that. They're obligated. But you know, you have those friends. They're friends. That's my friend. How do you know it's your friend? They'll be out there bailing you when you go to jail. They'll accept your collect call. You know what I mean? There's your friend. They hear, they're considerate of your needs. You don't even need to tell them. There's a need, they know it, they hear it. Oh. And they're like, oh, be a friend. There's that need, there's that thing right there. Amen? Some of your Facebook friends are your enemies. Some of them are only close to you just to make sure you don't get too far from them. Some people are in your life to as a tether. You guys remember tether ball? No matter how hard you hit that ball ain't going anywhere. It's just circling around that pole. And you're trying to figure out, why are you getting, you hit so hard, but all you're doing is going around in circles. Because there's somebody attaching you and not letting you go and do what God wants. So I'm talking to somebody here today. Somebody needs to hear this. Some people's got something tethered that's holding them to the world. And they can't get free because something's tethering them. You got to look at that and say, you know what, I'm sorry, but I can't be listening to you no more. God's got something special for me, and you're holding me back. You got to go. And please don't say that to your husband or wife. Someone, well, pastor, you said it on Sunday. You said it. I'm just being a faithful. you said. Amen. That's not what I mean. That's right. Eye to the world. Walk according to what God calls you to walk to. Amen. He says circumcision or uncircumcision doesn't avail. But a what? New creation. The Bible says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a what? New creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, what? All things become new. A new creation. When you came to Christ, out with the old, in with the new. You gotta come to your life, in your life, where you've got to look at all the old things in your life. I'm not talking about people either. The old self. Oh, the old sinful stuff. And you got to get rid of it. And you got to say, I'm no longer in the world. I'm no longer of the world. All this worldly stuff's got to go. And I got to start living for Christ. I got to start living for Christ. It's got to. And start doing the things God calls you to do. Amen? If you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I don't care if you are 70 years old, 80 years old, 90 years old, or whether you are 11 years old or 12 years old, whatever you are here, you have a what do you call it? A calling on you to come to God. He's calling you. And you, no matter what age you are, you still are, you have to get rid of the flesh and start living for God. I leave you this last part. I bear in my body the marks of the Lord Jesus. And here's what the Apostle Paul says. I preach against obeying the law for righteousness. And he says, if I preached obedience to the law for righteousness, I would not suffer persecution. If I preach, be circumcised and you'll be righteous, obey the law and you'll be righteous, and da-da-da-da, you'll be righteous, I would not suffer persecution. But because I preach against the law, but because I preach, not against the law, but because I preach against the law for righteousness, and because I'm against the Judaizers, I'm being beat up. In 2 Corinthians chapter 11, you'll see the story, shipwrecked, whipped, left for dead. All these things that happened in my life. My body, if the Apostle Paul lifted up his shirt, you'll see stripes upon his back. You'll see scars. And those scars are the mark of his persecution and his suffering for Jesus. Let me ask you a question. What's the mark that you carry in your life that shows that Jesus Christ is the Lord of your life? What shows? If someone were to come to you and say, are you a Christian? And you say, well, yeah, I'm a Christian. Prove to me you're a Christian. Show me. Well, look, I wear a cross. Do you have a testimony? Are you living your life for God? Are you being persecuted? Are you giving sacrifice? Are you not giving sacrifice, but have you sacrificed things in your life? There's sufferings. There's pains. There's all these things that as Christians we give up. Well, yes, I'm a believer. I gave up. I used to be an alcoholic. I surrender. I turn it all. I used to be a drug addict. Oh, I gave it all to God. I used to do this. I used to do that. I gave it all to God. Amen. I surrender all. I went through persecution. I went through things. I tried to evangelize to my family. I was cursed at, cussed at. All these things, these persecutions are marks. Don't go out and get a tattoo. Are you a Christian? Yeah, I want to see. Look, I got a cross tattooed right here on my... That's so silly. I remember when people were coming to Christ, they would go get tattoos, and they're like, yeah, look at this. And I'd be like, you're so silly. I wouldn't say it that way. I would be like, what are you doing? It's not what God wants inside the heart. Inside. What proof? He says, let no one trouble me, for I bear in my body the marks of the Lord Jesus. What proof do you have in your life that you bear also the marks of the Lord Jesus Christ in your life? Amen? Now, I'm not asking you to answer that, because you, each and every one of us, should have that in our mind and say, well, you know, I've gone through persecution. You don't have to explain it, but you should know in your own heart. You should know in your own heart the things that you've gone through for Christ. Not that he owes you anymore, but it says, hey, look at my life. I live for Jesus. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Father, we love you, Lord. We thank you. We thank you for your blessing. We thank you for everything you've shown us, Lord. We thank you for your love, your grace, your peace, your strength in us, Lord. We thank you, God, for making us righteous through your Son, Jesus, and letting us understand that our righteousness is not of our own, but it's only through your Son, Jesus Christ, are we saved. Lord, I pray if there's any here, God, who are struggling, who are depressed, who are feeling like giving up, I pray you touch their lives and you use them. You're a good God, Lord, and we love you. And we thank you, Lord. Reverend Ray, will you finish closing us in prayer? I'd ask you, please. Hallelujah.
Awesome word today. Father, we thank you and praise you for
number
this
one.
Awesome word today, Father. Father, we honor you and we magnify your name, Father, as we leave this place, Father. Let us walk worthy of your calling, Father. Let us be hearers of the word, doers of the word, Father, but let us walk more importantly for your word, Father. Let us look to the cross in everything we do. Father, when people see us, let them see Jesus Christ. Father, let them see him crucified through us. That we not follow the world's lead, Father. We are a peculiar people, Father. We honor you and we magnify your name, Father. We just want to live worthy for you, Father. It's all about you and not about us. So, Father, as we leave this place and never from your presence, Father, let us be about your business, Father. Father, you are the lover of our souls. So, Father, let us walk according to your word, Father. We thank you, Father, and we honor you. We honor your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, we don't just want to just walk any kind of way. We want to walk for you, Father. So I ask all these things in your Son's precious name. who I'll be careful to give you the glory in the blood of Jesus, in his precious name. Amen and amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, brother. Amen. Hallelujah. As we get dismissed, we're going to ask Deacon Gary, since you're here, will you pray over the food? We're going to pray over the food. Will you please?